thanks people for joining us today about discussing how we try to help about the CPU power management. So let me present myself. I'm Sylvain Boza. I'm the senior software engineer from Red Hat, working on Nova since the last decade. I'm also the OpenStack Nova PTL, and previously the last decade, I was also an operator.
Hello, so my name is René Ribaud. I'm a software engineer. I'm a quite new Nova contributor, and I discovered Linux and the Floss community in 1995. And previously, I worked as a solution architect, mostly on cloud and DevOps activities.
So let me explain how this story started. This story started because previously on the last Open Infra Summit that was in Berlin, someone from the BBC presented something that they were using called Scaffold for getting power measurements from their clouds. And when I saw it, I thought it would be nice if we could help at least the operators about that. So that's why we did it. Also, by the way, if you remember about last year, the electricity bills became more expensive. So I think it was nice to help how to have less power about that.
And also, we are all facing an enormous challenge about global warming. So that was one also of the motivation to work on that topic.
So after the summit, when we discussed, it was for the Antelope PTG. So the Nova community started to discuss about it. What we did is that, for example, we had two topics for discussing about that. We are having, for example, one topic for discussing how to reduce the power consumption.
And also another one about power management measurement and what we could reduce.
So first, about auto-reducing the power management. Maybe you know about that, but for example, so basically, sorry about that. what you can do with Linux for reducing the power. So basically, you have multiple ways to do it. So for example, for active or idle processes, what you can do with RHEL is that you can change what we name the CPU profiles by using something named tuned. So you have multiple CPU profiles. So for example, you can use a specific profile like, let's say, power save, or balanced, or a new tuned profile that's named CPU Partitioning Power Save that was created last, I think, on the last month. What you could do then, it's nice because then you can modify the sysets. It basically modifies the sysets, sorry, like using C3, which is good for active processes like DPDK. You can also ask the kernel to stop the CPU cores. That's something that the Linux kernel supports. Or you can also ask to reduce the CPU frequency by using CPU frec if the OS supports it. The only problem about that is that maybe you know about that already, but it's not automatically. So what we did is that when we thought about that, then we wonder how to automatically doing that with Nova. That was what we did last cycle on Antelope. So what we did is that we created new config options that were saying, for example, if you want Nova to support the power management, then you can say true. And then you have two strategies. First one is saying that you can offline a CPU core, Or instead of offlining the CPU core, the other strategy is saying, I would like to modify the CPU governor. Just to be clear, a CPU governor is about modifying the frequency for the CPU. So as you see, that's an example. You can say, in that example, that you would like to stop CPUs in between 2 and 17 if none of the instances are using them. That being said, that means that you need to make sure that those CPUs are dedicated for instances and are not shared in between instances. So that only works for pin CPUs. So basically, how does it work? So this is demo time. Hope it will be working. So in that example, I have a host with 8 CPUs. All of them are active, are currently active. If I'm modifying the Nova conf, in that example, I want to only use 2 CPUs to be dedicated, then I'm basically modifying the config options. When I will be restarting the Nova CPU, that's what I'm currently doing. I'm using DevStack here. Then if I'm looking back at the CPUs, as you can see, both of the physical CPUs are now stopped. Now, if I'm creating a new flavor that's asking for a dedicated CPU, in that case, I'm here in that example, I'm asking for one dedicated PCPU, then when I'm creating the instance, now this is active. Just before it becomes active, then basically Nova automatically online the CPU. In that example, given the instance was using CPU 6, it's basically online. And when I'm deleting the VM, or when I'm stopping the VM, then basically the CPU is going back offline. So that's it for the demo. Oops. Okay, but basically, how does this work? This is pretty simple. We use SysFS. So basically, with Linux, you have a specific SysFS file system. And here, for example, each of the CPUs is a directory from SysFS. So what the libvir driver is doing is that when restarting the Nova compute, we look at all the dedicated CPUs. And then we ask SysFS, we directly call SysFS, to either modify the file for online or to modify the file for CPU Frag Scaling Governor, if, by the way, the OS supports it again. No, not all the OSs support Scaling Governor, but for those who do, then you have that. And basically, when then you want to start an instance, or you want to create an instance, basically, we are basically getting the CPU from that instance. And again, we are calling SysFS to either online the CPU or modify the governor. Now that you have that, I personally think that you have some quick wins. You have some quick wins because given the current scheduler, I think it's nice to basically pack the instances to specific hosts. So basically, the power of that host will be better. You have multiple ways to pack your instances. Either you use a CPU white multiplayer, or you use a software affinity white multiplayer, or you can leave your user to ask to use the same host filter by the host parameter. What you can also do, if you want to pack your instances after they're created is that, of course, you can migrate your instances to move them to the exact same host. Or you can use Watcher if you want to do it quite automatically. That said, nothing is done automatically by the scheduler about some scheduling decisions related to the power measurement. Nothing is done automatically. So basically, you need to do this by yourself. As you understood, there are some limitations, though, with the new feature. The first one, I think you already understood it. This is only about dedicated CPUs. This is not about shared CPUs, because basically we don't exactly know whether the shared CPU is used or not, and by how many instances. So this is hardly ideal for public clouds. But for the other clouds that basically use dedicated CPUs, they can use that. Of course, if you have restricted CPUs that are reserved for, I would say, other processes but Nova, Nova won't be able to do this, right? Because those are reserved processes. I was talking, for example, about DPDK. That's one of the examples. Nova won't be able to modify the CPU of those other reserved CPUs. As a reminder as well, that's not only the CPUs that have power consumption, and like GPUs or NICs can have also large power measurement. So I think it's probably something we could be trying to see later, which will be about how to help that. But for the moment, this is only about CPUs. Also, if you really want to pack your instances on some specific hosts, then you may have some more power consumptions of the top of the rack switches. Because of course, you're basically sending all your instances to the same hosts, and basically the NICs will be having more usage. So it would be a problem with the switches. Maybe more power consumption. Basically, you need to monitor that. And eventually, I guess most of you are wondering, what exactly is the difference between an idle CPU or an active CPU? Because actually, that depends on the instances, on the workloads, if you prefer. And that's why I think it's also important, instead of just trying to like stop the CPU or start the CPU, to measure it in terms of what. And that's why we're moving to the next section.
Okay, so what we could improve on measurements. In fact, we looked at the BBC use cases, and the use cases is great, but they are measuring the consumption on the overall VMs. So we thought that we could improve it by giving the power consumption of processes inside the guest VMs. So the idea and the goal could be to enhance dashboards with more granular view, and also maybe to have dashboards more oriented, application oriented, and so users could act on. So what is Scaffold? So Scaffold is the underlying tool used by the BBC folks for their use cases. It's a monitoring agent dedicated to energy consumption metrics. The author of the tool is someone called Benoit Petit, and it's developed by the community. It's under Apache license, Apache V2 license. And I would like to make a strong disclaimer here, because this is a community tool without productization or support by Red Hat. How Scaffold is working. So Scaffold, when you start an instance of Scaffold, it defines server CPU topology. It gathers RAPL data. So RAPL data, it's data provided by the Intel technology to estimate CPU and RAM power consumptions. And on the other hand, it gathers system processes based on this collected data. Scaffold is doing some calculation to provide the consumption from the host down to the processes. So you will have the power consumption of host, CPUs, cores, and down to each individual processes. And when you have that, you can export this data using various common formats. So it could be Prometheus, which is the most famous one, and JSON, Riemann, a lot of formats. And combining with a tool like Grafana, you could do nice dashboards like you can see on the right. So how to expose and configure a scaffold to have the guest VM data? So on the left, you have the standard configuration. So you are just running an instance of scaffold on the compute host, and scaffold is providing so the processes consumptions, and you will have to look at the QEMU processes to have the consumption for your VMs. And moving to the right, this is the configuration with a QEMU exporter. So you are first, you need to run scaffold with a QEMU exporter on the compute host. And what it does, scaffold will extract the data for each QEMU processes into one directory. And scaffold will try to extrapolate the power consumption for these VMs into the form of a wrapper device. So basically, this is a kind of a trick to emulate or fake a wrapper device for guest VMs. Once you have done that, you need to share this data with either VirtIOFS or VirtIO9P from your host to the guest VMs. And finally, on each guest VMs, you will have to run scaffold with the --- VM option to collect this data. And then at that moment, you can use whatever exporter you want, and it will give the power consumption data of the processes for the guest VMs. And that's it. So, a quick glance of what is VirtIOFS and what we have implemented in Nova to support that. So VirtIOFS is a shared file system. It allows to share three directories and directory tree in between your host and your guest VMs. And the benefits of using VirtIOFS, it has the same semantics and performance as a local file system. So that's good. And to use that via libvirt, you need to configure that into the XML files, libvirt XML files. And that's the reason why we had to implement something, because the XML file is managed by Nova. You cannot modify it by hand. And that was the purpose of a feature we introduced initially to support Mania shares. This feature requires QEMU 5.0 and libvirt 6.2. And really important, the instances should use shared memory. So it means that on these instances, you will have to either configure file back memory or huge pages to use the features. The status of this feature is still in dev, because we have to fix some issues with Manila, but that should land hopefully in this cycle. So what about the scaffold features? So first, I would like to say we name it like this for convenience, because it was easier for us to share about it. But the idea was to share power data. So this is kind of tool agnostic. And basically, we leverage what we have done with VirtIOFS. What I just mentioned, and the idea was to share also a local share on your compute host to the guest VMs. To enable the features, you have two steps. The first step is to enable on the compute node. So this is done by using the share local FS parameter, and you have to supply the directory you want to share and a tag that will be used by the guest VMs. And on the instance, you had to enable that with using hardware power metrics parameter, and it can be done either via an extra spec or an image property. Time for the demo. So, quick demo just to kind of proof of concept. So, basically, it runs on an already configured compute host. And so, I have created a new flavor, passing the hardware share local FS parameter. So, now I will resize a VM, stop and resize a VM to use the these new flavors with the parameter to enable, let's say, the scaffold feature. So when it's done, I will start the demo instance. So if we just have a quick look at the Nova compute logs, we can see we have a section in that file system section defining the shares. And if we connect to the guest VMs, you can see that you can look at the metadata of the guest VMs using a curl command. So that will list the fact that we have a share and a tag called scaffold. So we could use that tag to mount the share. So that's done here. And if we look at into the share, we can see that we have Intel REPL data. And then, because we have the good data, we can start scaffold, and the scaffold is currently trying to process the data, and you can see that we associate power consumptions with the processes. So for the moment, this is just a POC. This is as well not merged, so it might change in the future because I have some comments to change some stuff. And also, don't really look at the data. That was more or less fake data. Just for purpose of showing it works. Okay, what about the limitation? So right now we have some limitation due to VirtioFS and the shared memory. And in fact, the limitations also are from QEMU because QEMU has to disable some features like migration or snapshots. Because when you have a file system attached, they have some, let's say, more development to do around that. So as a result for Rust, we had to disable some operations like resize, migrate, shelve, live migrate, and evacuate. So this is quite annoying for the moment, because if you want to use that kind of operations, you need to stop, you need to unshare by stopping your VM. Another limitation, as Sylvain mentioned, we just have the CPU and memory consumptions, so we are missing the GPU one, even if it might be introduced into scaffold soon. And also, more complex topic, we don't have the devices like NICs or FPGA. And maybe another limitation is that REPL, like I said, it's an Intel technology, so it's available on Intel and AMD. So it means that that's not supported on ARM or RISC-V CPUs. And finally, what are the next steps, improvements, and ideas we are on these topics? So first, QEMU upstream has already tickets and they already works on removing the limitations, operational limitations. So we could do as well on Nova when it will be available. So this is one of the axes. Another possibility, we have a colleague which is called Anthony Arrivel, and basically, what Anthony has done, he put into QEMU the mechanism used by scaffold for calculating the power consumptions. And so that will be available into QEMU if the patch is accepted. And at that moment, it means that sharing will not be required anymore. So that could be a nice improvement. obsoleting what we have done so far. And another alternative, instead of using Virta-UFS, I mentioned that really quickly, we could use another protocol, which is Virta-U9P. And Virta-U9P does not require shared memory. So in the meantime, it could allow to, we will not have to reduce the operational stuff. So if you are interested by that feature, maybe we will discuss that in tomorrow PTG sessions. And we also have a tool called Kepler. So Kepler is a tool that using machine learning to predict consumption. So maybe that's another way to let's say have better results and maybe to deal with all the devices and things like that. And by the way, maybe Kepler will be fully supported by Red Hat, so could be another alternative.
Voilà, that's it for our presentation. Maybe you have questions. We are here for that, so no worries. Any questions, so?
Yeah, so I would like to ask about the option to turn off and on idle and active the CPU. So first, does it have to be done on a host-by-host basis?
Yes.
Or it can be done for multiple hosts at the same time?
It's a compute-specific config option.
Okay.
So basically, either you modify, of course, all your config, all your modifier, your computes. But yeah, basically, it's per compute.
And the second question is, does this feature respect the machine slice setting? So it can only process CPUs that are dedicated for virtual machines, or?
Correct. So basically, what we do, if you prefer, is that, for example, say you reserve some CPUs outside of Nova when you modify the config options by saying, OK, those are the reserved CPUs, and I only want to take those dedicated CPUs. That's, we are basically using the CPU dedicated set that people are using. That's the new config option name that we had previously that were named, I think, pin CPUs. I can't remember exactly the right name, but that was the previous name of the config option. So basically, what we do is that we just take those specific CPUs, and then we basically stop them. But for all the other reserved CPUs, by the way, I forgot about that, but we also don't support CPU 0, because in general, CPU 0 is used by the kernel and for other processes. So you can't just try to modify CPU 0. If you do that, then you will have some problems. But yeah, basically, it's just about the physical CPUs that you can use for Nova.
Yeah, so you have to be careful to manage only CPUs that are not used by other systems. So this feature does not checks any that these CPUs are in the machine slice or that are allocated for now.
Yeah, basically, if you already support, if you already use basically pin CPUs, that's something that we already support, like I can't remember, for like a lot of years before. Basically, what we do is that we basically offline them if you don't use them. That's basically what we do.
Thanks.
Any other questions?
Am I got it right? If you just using the bare metal configuration, you don't need all these limitations.
You're talking about the offline online stuff?
Yeah.
So what do you mean by bare metal?
When you just put it into the host and you don't need to care about use pages on the VM side, because
No. Yeah, indeed. I mean, say for huge pages or for other stuff. Again, it's just about CPU pinning. It's just about CPU pinning. So again, if you use CPU pinning, basically we will be offlining it.
Thank you.
No worries. Yeah, I mean, fine.
What's the impact of the consumption to disable one core or not?
Very good question. Very, very good. I was pretty sure that someone was asking for it. So basically, the measurement of that, basically, it's a very good question. I'm not seeing someone that that was trying to look at that. I would say, for the instances, it would be good. But sometimes, about the performance, what I would say is that from what I heard, because I'm just a developer, right? I'm not really testing it, but I mean, surely I'm testing it, but not about measuring the power. What I'm saying is that, yeah, basically, I would say for instances that's nice in terms of the power measurement that you have. For example, if you use that, cool. In general, if you use, for example, NFV, and then, for example, you have SRU VFs with DPDK and something else, maybe you could try to use TuneD. That's what I said in a specific slide, for those other processes like DPDK. And that's why I told about the TuneD profile, because that's what we saw at Red Hat. It also helps those processes. Voilà. Other questions?
Yeah, so I was curious to know if there is any effort or any idea on actually extending this idea of power saving to actually completely switch off an hypervisor when it's not used.
Wow. Excellent question. I haven't thought about it yet. Yeah, I mean, in general, you know, Nova doesn't. I mean, that's done by. I mean, that wouldn't be done by Nova automatically. That would be done by a deployment tool. So I would say that would depend on the deployment tool. About measuring the power, good question. The problem is that if you basically stop the host and then you restart it, sometimes about the measurement of the power and the time it takes, maybe it's maybe not that good. So maybe you should be continue to just run it and try to have, like I said, C states for the other processes. I think it would be better, I guess. Anyway, I think we're on time, so thanks
Thank you.
All. And we have our names, so if you have any questions.